I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Our feet shall stand within thy gates, O Jerusalem. Because of the house of the Lord our God, I will seek thy good. Blessed are they that dwell in thy house. Lord, I have loved thy habitation, the place where thy honor dwelleth.
For the Lord is his holy temple, and all the earth is silence before him.
Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer.
O sing unto the Lord a new song, when he has done marvelous things, and make the joy of the Lord to the Lord. All the earth sing his praises.
Oh, won't he do it? God is good, and God is good all the time. And since he's so good, we're going to open up our morning hymn of worship. We're marching to Zion, the 520th hymn.
Marching up to Zion, that beautiful city of God. Amen. Happy Palm Sunday to everyone. The Sunday when Jesus begins his journey toward the cross for his resurrection and his crucifixion and resurrection. That's what we are celebrating all this week. And as we go through each and every day this week, let us continue to read the word of the journey that God, that Jesus takes each day. And may we follow his example and do all the good things, even to his journey. Our Father God, here we are. Here we are just once more, a few of your children, Lord. We come in to give you your highest praise. Heavenly Father, we come in ready to go from heart to heart and from breast to breast. Not as one individual, but one collectively. To show you, Lord Jesus, that we love you. And we love you alone. Heavenly Father, we come just to say thank you, Lord, for the air that you continue to give us to breathe. Thank you for the sun that you continue to let shine. Heavenly Father, thank you for the clouds that you continue to show in the sky. Thank you for giving us the eyes that we may see. Thank you for giving us the ears that we may hear. The wind when it blows and the birds when they sing. We thank you, Lord. Now, Heavenly Father, let us use all the abilities of all of our senses that you have given unto us. That when we hear the word of the Lord, Heavenly Father, that it may do what you would have it to do. Convict, convert, and it may shine all over your world. Heavenly Father, we can't thank you enough for the journey that you took for us a long time ago. Heavenly Father, bless those who want to be here, but for one reason or another, they're not. And Heavenly Father, bless all of our sick and our shut-in, and continue to bless those who we know to call and those we don't know who to call. And Heavenly Father, we can't thank you enough for you brought us through last night. And you touched us this morning with your finger of love. I thank you, Jesus, that you continue to give me the ability to bow down my head and pray and say, thank you, Jesus. If we don't know how to do anything else, we can say, thank you, Jesus. And he will hear and answer our prayers. Bless the vessel that shall come forth. Build them up on every leaning side, Lord Jesus. Crown them from the crown of his head to the soles of his feet. That he may preach what thus saith the Lord. And when we leave this place, Lord Jesus, let us continue to take you with us, that we may let our little light shine for you in that old sinful world. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. Hear our prayer. And incline. Lord, and grant us thy peace. Amen. Amen.
Jesus. want to tell you.
Gospel of Matthew, chapter 21. Matthew 21. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethpage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there with her colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, say that the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away." This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophets. "Say to daughter Zion, see, your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." The disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and placed their cloaks on them for Jesus to sit on. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." That is Matthew chapter 21, verses 1 through 9. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading, hearing, and doing of his most holy word from all that dwells below the skies.
Amen.
God spake all these words, saying, I am the Lord thy God that brought thee out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. And he said to him, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the great and first commandment, and the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Glory. Happy Sunday. Good morning, God's saints. I know God has chose this personality to proclaim the message of God. I want you to know, if you have not been fully paying attention, all personalities are not the same. Amen. We are different. Each person is uniquely gifted by God and different in their expression. I, however, have been down the road a couple of times and got stopped and been through a lot of foolishness. And God says, oh, that's all right. Come on. I can use you. Amen. Amen. So you don't always have to be top of the class, straight A's, and always doing this and bringing the teacher an apple. I was the one throwing the apple and pointing. He did it. Amen. Or I just ate the apple myself. But God uses all of that. And I use humor also a lot in the stuff. Some people might say it's silly. Well, you don't really want me to be my raw self. Amen. My raw self is Bernie Mac. My raw self is Richard Pryor. Amen. You don't want that. Let's stick with the Sinbad and the Happy, Reverend Happy. How about that? But the point is to get over the gospel message in our understanding. And in teaching the word of God, I want to present the word of God to where we understand it. You do not speak King James English. You don't speak good English. Amen? Now one of us do. Amen. We don't understand good English. Can I get an amen? Amen. I do, Pastor. They drop them off over in England, see how they get along. Amen. What? We'll do that. But I try, and we don't know sheep, because some of you don't know farm. I shouldn't say that, because this farm is all over the place here. But you'd be surprised how many people don't know what a chicken is or where the egg come from. And with the cows and all the other stuff and the agriculture, because that was in biblical times. You know, the masonry and doing all of the things that they do. So I try to explain it in what you see and what's going on. Same principles, different application. So that's what I'm saying. Now, part of the teaching moment is, what then Romans chapter 8, shall we say in response to these things, if God is for us, who can be against us? All right, here comes Jenkins' interpretation. I know our society has lost its mind. I know we are facing persecution because of race, because of gender. I know it's an inequality. No, life is not fair. I know even those that are in our families sometimes turn their backs on us. Can I get a witness? Amen. Friends ain't friends no more. Amen. Money acting funny. Am I the only one money act funny? Oh, y'all just got it going on. Well, hit the pastor with a couple of it then, since you got it going on. But my money be laughing. It's like it's on a comedy show. Amen. I said, this joker done won the comedy show. But even as these things occur, this is reminding me, if God is for us, who? And I noticed that Paul is really not expecting you to respond with an answer, because the answer is so obvious. God is so good, and God is so powerful, and God is beyond all things, and God is in control of all things. So Pontus said, if God is for us, who can be against us? If he did this to his son, and his son took the punishment of our sins, if he did that, how much more is he going to bless you? Who going to bring charges against those whom God has chosen? But we start sweating bullets when folk look at us funny. Oh, you go to church. And your breath stinks. I told you I say stuff. You were thinking it. Amen. Who gonna bring charges? Why do we let other people sweat what we're doing? Why do we let situations and folk hold us back from our blessing? Paul is saying, you got to get to the point to where you don't let nobody keep you from your blessing. Don't let nobody keep you from moving forward. Don't let nothing keep you. Who then is who condemns? He's telling you, no one. It's rhetorical questioning. It's a question with the answer. We understand rhetorical. We understand mama. You know how mama's asked them questions, she already know the answer too. Shut up, I'm talking to you. Amen. Don't you answer me and get smart with me. But it's one of those type of questions. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ when God is for us? So what I'm saying is, we need to quit sweating. We need to quit worrying about mess, because mess is going to keep coming. Hospital runs going to keep coming. Age is going to keep coming. What you used to could do, you can't do. Amen. Yeah. I can cut the grass, but I'm going to have to sit down for a while. Ooh. Yep. Amen. Amen. I used to cut 5-6 yards. Not no more. Cut 1 yard one day. Amen. But he says, not death, not life, nor angels or demons, nor present, nor future, nor any power. Not even my own inability. He says, I got you. So the teaching moment is, trust God. Know that he's with you. Know that God is able. Quit worrying about what God can do. Just trust him to do what he does. God bless you. Y'all ready to have some church? Amen. How come six people were clapping? Are y'all ready to have church?
And I know
I owe my life.
I want to stay focused in on the season. That's why I chose this particular passage, lifting out the 6th through the 8th verses. The disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and placed their cloaks on them for Jesus to sit on. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from trees and spread them on the road. The road of passion. The road of passion. That is our subject that we'll be dealing with out of Matthew 21, is the road of passion.
Well,
as we begin traveling down this road towards Easter, which is the death, burial, and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ, we come to this road of passion, which is a road that leads to Jerusalem. It was God's passion to so love the world that he gave his only begotten son to travel this road for this moment to redeem lost souls. So we observe this road of passion called Palm Sunday, which is the triumphal entry into Jerusalem by our Lord. We're granted this privilege to go down this road with him. It was a day when Jesus came to his own and his presence proclaimed that he is the promised Messiah, that I am your king. This is the last week that he will spend his life as a man on this earth. Oh, yeah. So Matthew speaks of this road to Jerusalem, which is the end of the ministry, earthly ministry. It is a road that has a dead-end street.
Well,
leads to death. But it also leads to a glorious resurrection. I looked at this and I said, Lord, this is a, like life.
Well,
because life is described as a road that one must travel. Life is a journey with hills and valleys and, somebody help me, potholes.
Well.
Critters running out in front of you.
Yes, sir.
There's dangers out on that road, seen and unseen. Life goes from tribulation to triumph. It is a journey from birth to death and then beyond. There's many roads we gonna be on. We're talking about the road of passion here, but there's a Damascus road. Oh, that's salvation. There's a road called Bethany. There's a road called Jericho. That's a road of service. There's a road to Jerusalem of suffering and triumph. There's a, on the other side of that road is a road called Emmaus. That's the road of satisfaction. So imagine yourself over 2,000 years ago, it's a crowd coming from all over the kingdom. Why was they there? They come to celebrate Passover. I believe it was Josephus, a noted Jewish historian, that estimated that over 2 million people progressed upon this city. It was noted that over 250,000 lambs were slaughtered. Each lamb represented at least 10 worshipers. So it was thousands from all over the world coming here to observe Passover. And on that day, many saw this Messiah. Some of them seen him firsthand and watched him open some eyes that were blind.
Ah, yes, sir.
Oh, yeah, that's him.
Yeah.
Some of them saw him take a couple of fish.
Well.
And some loaves and fed thousands of folk.
Yeah.
Oh, that's the one right there.
Uh-huh.
So these people saw this Messiah, and he came into this passion, this road of passion. Mm-hmm. And there was some folk there that said, there's our king, Hosanna, in the highest.
Well.
But I'm telling you, you get some folk praising, you got some other folk cussing.
Well.
You got some folk glad to see you, but some folk aren't like that. You can't please folk. Some of you trying to please everybody. You can't please everybody.
That's right.
Don't worry about it. Just do what you do. Be who you are. You've been running yourself crazy trying to fit in and please everybody. You don't like what you see? Bada bing, bada boom. You got to go.
Well.
It is what it is. What do you want me to tell you? But through it all, we find that on this Resurrection Sunday, Jesus rose forevermore king. Because he traveled down this road of passion. And he says, you can secure this road that leads to victory as well.
Well,
what do we do on this road of passion? What is indicated on this road? What are some of the signs and landmarks on this road? Well, first, I see that it is a road of humility. Watch in verses 1 through 3. When they drew near to Jerusalem and came to Bethpage at the Mount of Olives, then Jesus sent his two disciples saying, go to the village opposite you, and immediately you're going to find a donkey tied and a colt there with her. Loose them and bring them to me.
Uh-huh.
I'm sure many people had all kind of thoughts in their head, but here's the one that's going to free us from Rome. Here's the one that's going to restore the kingdom of David and with all his glory. But Jesus came in the road of humility. What's he going to do with a donkey? A colt. Because known at that time, if you're a king, oh, you coming in on a white stallion. Fine, majestic animal.
Well.
You coming in with all the pomp and circumstances. Huh. No. I'm coming in on a coat.
Well.
I'm coming in humility. Watch this. But Jesus chose this road of humility. It reflected the life of Christ was a life of humility. He didn't come into this world with wealth. He came in poverty. He didn't come with affluence. He came with meekness, not for material fortune and fame, but in humility. He spoke of his kingdom. He spoke in terms of being one of service.
Well, come on.
Of what I can give and what I can do. Maybe that's why nothing get done today.
Well,
Because everybody wants to get something. What can you do for me? Everybody still remember Janet Jackson, what have you done for me lately? Amen. Everybody wants something, but everybody don't want to bring something. Oh, you want to come to the cookout and eat these ribs. But you don't want to go buy the meat. At least you can go get some nearest green or something. Did I say that? I'm sorry. I mean, go get some water. You can stop by Kroger and get some bottled water. Amen. We always want something. What is it in it for me?
Well,
I heard folks, I didn't get nothing out of that church. I didn't get nothing out of that church. What did you bring? You got what you got because of what you gave. If you gave nothing, you get nothing. But the more you give, what it says, the more he gives to you. You can't outgive God. So he spoke of humility going down the road. The road to the cross means giving up my selfish desires and says, what can I do? So it was a road of humility. Secondly, it was a road of fulfillment. Verse 4 and 5, Matthew is actually quoting Zechariah in 9:9. Rejoice greatly, O daughters of Zion. Shout, O daughters of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. He is just and having salvation, lowly and riding on a donkey. That was just one of 332 Old Testament prophecies. That are fulfilled in the person of Jesus Christ. The mathematical odds of that, oh, you can't calculate it. It's around 84 to the 123rd power. It shows that Jesus is indeed the Messiah. God's beloved son that will bring to pass his mighty plan. There was a lot of prophecies about him portrayed in the Old Testament and painted thousands, hundreds of years before he even showed up, that he's going to be sold for 30 pieces of silver, about $25. False witnesses accusing him, silent when accused, struck and spit upon, but didn't say one word, and suffered for our stead, hands and feet are pierced, mocked and insulted, his side will be pierced, soldiers will gamble over his clothes, and not a bone will be broken on his body, buried in a rich person's tomb, and it goes on and on and on. He fulfilled all of those things. Shows that the whole life of Christ was the divine plan of the Almighty God to redeem us, to save us from our sin, to fulfill his promise to us. I'll never leave you nor forsake you. So we too must be willing to travel down the road of fulfillment with Jesus. We must be willing to fulfill and follow God's will for our lives. Too many times we back off of what God would have us to do. We look down the road and see where it's leading, and sometimes it leads where our flesh does not want to go. I know mine did. Look down the road of being a pastor, looking through my father, Reverend Jones, and a whole bunch of other ones. I ain't going down that road. It's crazy folk down that road. I ain't going down that road. You ain't got no money. I ain't going down that road, the parsonage. I ain't living in that little rat shack. I'm living in a mansion. Amen. I'm not doing that. Go to school. One, I hate school. And then you want a doctorate degree? You going to pay me $200,000 a year. Amen. Point blank, period, end of discussion. Not doing that. But it was a road of fulfillment. You got to follow Jesus. He traveled down that road to fulfill the will of our future. Thirdly, it was a road of submission. Obedience to the Father. Verses 6 and 8. So the disciples did and went and did as Jesus commanded them.
Well,
Jesus' whole life was one of submission to the Father. For I have come down from heaven not to do my will, but the will of him who sent me. John 3:38. Jesus' purpose was to do the will of God. Few days after his entry into Jerusalem, you find him in the garden praying to the Father. Lord, my Father, if this is possible, if this cup can pass from me, nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. Jesus foresaw his death, his suffering, but he ends the prayer, not as I will, but as I will, so that you may be glorified. So it is a road of submission and obedience. The disciples obeyed him. They were told where and how to get what they needed. They probably thought it strange, but they did it anyway. Sometimes God gonna tell you to do something and it ain't gonna make no sense. Just go and do it anyway. Well, I'm hurting, Pastor. Come to church anyway.
Well,
you don't understand. I just lost myself. Come to church anyway. But I had a hard week, and I got a hard week. I could come to church anyway. Because you're going to need that strength. You're going to need that reviving. You're going to lead that person telling you, my peace I give to you. You're going to lead some restoration in your soul. Because where do you get strength?
Yes, sir.
God. When I'm overwhelmed and struggling with life, who can stop it? God. When I'm sick and I don't know if I'm going to make it, who's the great physician? God. So why on earth would I go the opposite direction? You do if you want death. You do if you want the same thing. You do if you want to keep repeating stupid over and over and over and over again and then expecting a different result. Is that not the definition of insanity? So you're saying you're crazy.
Well,
the definition of insanity is doing the old same thing over and over again expecting a different result.
Well,
is it not? But if you do it, you're not crazy. No, you're crazy. I'll help you with that. Amen. Are you gonna call? I was crazy too. Amen. Yeah, that was crazy. But Jesus says, submit. Let go. Let me in your life and let me do it for you. Let me help you out because I am the one that can do it. I am the one that can speak a word. I am the one that can say, peace, be still. I can control the weather. I can control your boss. I can control the company. I can control the society. I can control the state to leave you alone. I can control the government.
Well,
and say, don't touch them. So I'm going to the Father. We need to follow Christ down this road. If we want to heaven as our home, we must be willing to go by way of submission.
Well,
that road. And finally, there's a road of destiny.
Mm-hmm.
Notice the last three verses. Then the multitudes who went before and those who followed cried, saying, Hosanna. Son of David, blessed is he that comes in the name of the Lord. And when he had come into Jerusalem, the city was moved, saying, who is this? Now, destiny is the setting apart for a specific, special purpose. It speaks of the inevitable. Christ is here met with words of destiny. Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. From his very birth, Christ was destined to die on the cross. Oh, he knew he was That's what I was here for. Don't be stopping me. Don't be keeping me from my destiny, because I know what I'm going to be doing. Mary, Jesus' mother here on earth, and then Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, his mother, behold, this child is destined for the fall and rising of many in Israel. Then in Revelation, you're going to hear that the lamb that was slain from the foundations of the world, from the very beginning of existence, the word Christ was destined to die for our sins. He understood his destiny. This road of destiny is a road that began at Bethlehem, and he born and lived a sinless life. And this road taught him with authority. He taught with authority. He taught not like the scribes and the other teachers of the law, but he taught like the one that wrote the book. Performed many miracles, changed many lives, and he made his triumphal entry into Jerusalem, was worshiped and praised by many. He would face great agony in the Garden of Gethsemane. Many of the same people that's going to smile in your face.
Hey. Well, well.
And say, Hosanna.
Well.
Give them a moment. Mm. They're going to be cussing you out.
Well, well.
Crucify him.
Uh-huh.
Crucify him. Then he will be betrayed by Judas, the devil that he already knew. Judas was a disciple. No, he was never saved. But never saved. He had the opportunity to be.
Well,
but he chose his life. He was denied by even Peter. Oh, Lord, if everybody else leave you, I won't leave you. Peter, I tell you. For the cock crow.
Well, well.
You're going to deny me multiple times.
Uh-huh.
Amen.
Uh-huh.
Abandoned by his disciples, seized and arrested by his enemy, falsely tried and convicted. You know, if folk can't get you for the truth, they'll create a lie just for you. He would hear the crowd say it. Not even Pontius Pilate could prevent Christ's destiny. He tried to satisfy. Yes, he did. He tried. He says, I'll give you Barabbas. Yeah. Or you want Yeshua. Give us Barabbas. Yes, he did. Then he was going to be scourged. His flesh is going to be ripped.
Yeah.
Thorns are going to be placed on his brow. He's going to be stripped. Oh, you didn't go to the cross with your clothes on. You went naked. You're parading through the street naked. You're getting spat on by the crowd. And you know when folk want to get you back, you thought you were all that. Now look at you. Yeah, they were taunting him and criticizing him. And then they would crucify him. Well, my Lord was so good. You didn't take my life.
Well, well, well.
Mm. I laid it down.
Yes, sir.
Oh, my Father. He was so cool. He said, Father, into thy hand I give you my spirit.
Yes, sir.
Oh, didn't nothing take control of my Lord. He even said, hold up, death, I got this.
Well, well.
You don't take it from me.
Ah.
I'll let you hold it for a couple of days.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
But praise God, he would come out of that tomb.
Uh-huh.
Oh, yeah. They wrapped his body up.
Yeah, yeah.
He ain't even disturbed the wrapping.
Well.
My Lord just, what's up?
Well,
put a big old stone there. What's up?
Well, well.
Oh, he good. Then he was seen by his disciples and many witnesses. And then a couple of more days, he ascended on to heaven.
Mm-hmm.
All of them sitting up there watching.
Well, well.
Some angels that were watching came down and said, hey, what y'all looking at?
Uh-huh.
The same way he left, the same way he gonna come back. What did he tell you to go do? Now go do it. He did it all for our redemption. Oh, I know I'm preaching up in here. I know I'm talking about the passion of the Christ. I know he came to bring a new destiny for you and I. Christ was destined to die that we may live. And since I met a man named Jesus, I'm destined to live with him now and forevermore. There's a choice of two destinies for all mankind. There's a narrow road. And then there's a broad one. Oh, yes, it is. There's a path that is straight. Then there's one that got all them little crooked lines and stuff in it. There's a road that leads to hell. Pastor, do you believe in hell? Word, yes. Guess what? I believe there's a devil too. I met that joker. I believe in there's demons. Amen. I believe there's angels.
Yeah.
Well, what's all their names? I don't even know their names. Don't want to know their names.
No, sir.
Only name I want to know is Jesus. Because I believe all of them got an answer to him.
Well,
I believe if Jesus said, help him, they'll help me.
Well,
if Jesus said, leave him alone, they'll leave me alone.
That's it.
Amen.
Yes.
Once you follow this road and you meet a man named Jesus, you follow him down the road that leads to heaven. It is a road of humility, a road of fulfillment, a road of submission, a road of destiny. And there are other roads that you can travel. But no road leads you to the Messiah except a road that's on a hill. Far away stood an old rugged cross. And on that cross, he died for us. So I suggest to avoid getting lost. You better find some folk that got good directions. And good directions usually gonna have some landmarks. Even though we may be given a list of directions to tell you which way to turn and which way to go, the inclusion of the landmarks lets us know that we're traveling on the right road.
Come on now.
Those who are trying to find their way to heaven should look for the landmark. The landmark is not a store. It is not 7-Eleven or Circle K or Mapco. It is not Walmart, Kroger's, or Publix. But the landmark is a cross called Calvary.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Just a little ways down from Gethsemane. And when you come down that road of passion,
yes, sir,
and you get to that old rugged cross,
come on,
you better remember what John says, if I be lifted up from the earth, I'll draw all men unto me.
Yes, sir.
Because it was at that cross,
at the cross,
that I have been redeemed.
Yes, sir.
At the cross,
yes, sir,
I no longer get lost. At the cross, God gave me some coordinates and a GPS system and a tracking tag all in me. So when I get off course, it go beep, 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 beep.
Well,
beep, 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 beep.
Well,
and it helps me to stay on track. The Holy Spirit guides me and is with me all the time. Better than OnStar.
Well,
better than Apple Maps.
Well,
better than Google Drive away.
Come on now.
I'm telling you, to tell you every stop along the way.
Well,
just follow him and keep following him and keep following him. So if we want to go to where Jesus is, the way to get there is through the road that leads to glory, the cross of Jesus Christ. So whatever you do, you better listen to me, because I know what I'm going to do. I'm pressing on. Upward way.
Yes, sir.
New heights I'm gaining.
Every day.
Still praying as I'm onward bound.
Well,
Lord.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Plant my feet.
Yeah. Oh,
on higher ground.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm heading home.
Yeah.
I got a few people with me too.
Well,
we going home.
Yeah.
One day and we on that road.
Yes, sir.
God bless you. God smile upon you.
Yeah.
The road of passion. Now, the invitation, after we worship and praise God and you're seeking God, you've heard the Spirit speak to you and tell you, you need to be on I-65, but you're on I-24. You need to cut across on 84, what is that, 880, 840? And get on over here to 65. Amen.
Amen.
'Cause 24 ain't gonna lead you over here.
Well,
don't wait till you get to Clarksville.
Well,
amen. Get off at the next exit.
Well,
turn around and come back and let it guide you. So the invitation of Christian discipleship, won't you stand? If you know that your guidance system is broken or you need one, please give your life to Jesus Christ. If you need a church home, we're waiting on you. We're waiting on you.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Mm-hmm.
Amen. And as they finish the offering, just a quick announcement. We got a few announcements coming, but one of them is the Maury County Surrounding Areas Ministerial Alliance is having the Seven Last Words of Christ. That'll be Friday, March the 29th at 6 p.m. at Wayman Chapel here in Columbia. And it looked like I'm... Ooh. Okay. Yay. Yeah, they sent it out, and I was like, hey, that looked like me. And I was like, oh, it is me. Oh, I guess I better get to work on the sermon. So that's fine. We're going to do the seven last words. We're going to have a good time and celebrate all of the ministerial and be over there with my sister, Reverend Sharon Ogilvie. Yay. And all choir members, all y'all that can sing and all y'all that can hum. Amen. And we go over there and worship the Lord. The other thing is the pastor wants to do. Now see, at the previous charge, we were used to doing sunrise service. I mean, 6 o'clock, sunrise service. Oh, Lord. I'm so glad y'all don't do that. No, wait a minute. No, you got to calculate.
Wait.
It's an hour distance. So that means we got to get up at 3 to get down here. 2:30, really, to get down here for sunrise. So, ooh, Lord Jesus. Praise the Lord. Because over there, sunrise was like, the church was like 9 minutes from my house. So it's, hello. You know, so it was, but like, no. But what we're going to do, what Pastor, I guess God has put in my heart, talking with folk, we want to have a special Easter presentation, probably at 8:30. 8:30 now. Can y'all do that? 8:30. And you're going to love the presentation for Easter, because if you're a Christian, you need to see it. Because it's hard to explain scripture to you just with words. You need to see it. Once you see it, you understand it. You know, you talk about a cross. No, you're thinking about the jewelry. When you see a real cross, that's an emblem of death and suffering. When you talk about nails, you thinking about the nails you use to put up picture frame. No. Nails. That long. You need to see the visual representation. Oh, I can't watch that. You can't watch what your Lord did for you? You can't watch how he did it for you? See, that's why a lot of folk are not grateful. Because once you see what he did, and he did that for you, he took your place. So please, 8:30, it's on. It's on. Amen. And we're going to have a good time. I guarantee you it's going to be transformative. I guarantee it. So those are the two things that I want and that we'll be having that relates to this week of passion. Check out the Facebook, because I'm going to put the week of passion stuff, the meaning of each day, so that you'll understand that. And again, I'm still revising those booklets and stuff, but I need the emails, and I got some other stuff, but other ones I don't have. So I need names, numbers, email address, so when it comes out, because we're going to save the trees and save the forest. I just email you the document, and you have it digitally. Amen? Praise God. Let's see. Brother Washington. See, he got that cool walk. Look at him. That's swag right there.